The following program contains graphic material, including offensive language. Viewer discretion is advised.
It's Empty Wheel Friday on the Nicole Sandler Show.
Oh, we love Fridays. Yes, you know the deal now by now. For all the reasons, every Friday is a good Friday. But Marcy Wheeler is here, so we get to get her expert take on some of the things that happened this week. And it was, go figure, another eventful week in America. But we have to start with the update on my house hunting. We found a house. Finally. In fact, we signed the lease electronically, digitally, Saturday night. So after we spoke last Friday. And we've now begun moving stuff in and everything. But last night when we were taking a load of stuff over there, and we realized that we hadn't double checked on who our congressional representative is.
Oh, no!
So here we live in Chandler, Arizona, and Greg Stanton is our congressman in this right. Still the old house.
It was great. Yeah. So he's great.
Well, we are about four blocks, seriously, into District 5 instead of District 4. Our representative is Andy Biggs.
That's going to be so awesome.
It
oh
is?
My God, you're going to have so much fun. You are going to have fun. And then we'll run you against Biggs next
time. Oh, God,
time.
No.
Of course we will.
No, we won't. But I guess I can make some noise. So, and I'm trying to look at it.
We're going
to
have fun. Andy Biggs, you don't know what has hit you.
Oh my God. I can't believe I'm in Andy Biggs' district. So, yeah. So, you know, trade one thing for another. It's okay. So here we go. It'll be interesting, if nothing else. For those who don't know, he's a certified nut. His family, I haven't seen any this time around, but his family has come forth and said, do not vote for this man. He's nuts.
And you can follow their instructions from here on out.
Oh.
You don't vote in his district.
Yes.
In November, do you?
Yes,
you
I do.
Oh, wow.
Because
okay.
I already put in our change of address that updates the voter registration. So they'll at least have two more votes against him. But when I realized this, I emailed Howie Klein last night and I asked, what do you know about Kristen Schaffner, I think is her name, who is the challenger, the Democratic challenger? And I said, do you know anything about Kristen Schaffner? He said, nope, but she's going to lose.
Okay. Right. Yeah. Okay.
Yep. So
crazy how those things happen that like just a few blocks can change that.
Yeah. So here we go. But by next week when we talk, I'll be in the new studio when we're done recording because we tape Friday mornings. So by the time this is airing, I will hopefully be bringing stuff over to the new house and getting the new studio built. So we're back on the air Monday. Fingers crossed. I do it all myself. So it's, you know, you never know. I'm bringing a lot of spit and bubble gum. That's how I put things together. Anyway.
Luckily, you're an old pro.
So. Oh, I've done it too many times. So anyway, here we are. Marcy Wheeler is here from emptywheel.net. And when we spoke last, we were talking about Jack Smith's filing. And he had gotten, I guess, approval from Judge Shutkin to file a longer, not so brief brief that to lay out his case on why I guess Trump should not be immune from the case that he wants to lay out, that he's going to lay out. And it was sealed. And as you said, we didn't know for sure when it was going to be unsealed or released. And that actually happened Wednesday. So I guess you've read the whole thing once or twice.
Something like that, yeah. Well, let's go back, actually.
Okay.
So Judge Chutkin said Tuesday at noon, you have to submit your filing. And rather than submit a filing saying we want to hide that Jason Miller knows that I lost the election in 2020, which is, you know, one of the things that I never stopped going back to, which is that if this ever were to go to trial, Jason Miller would be an absolutely critical witness. And yet he's still out there, you know, supporting Trump's false claims this time around. So rather than doing that, they kind of did this, oh, we think that this is all political. And I mean, setting the deadline for midday like she did was sort of a tell that she wasn't going to wait around.
Uh-huh.
So that happened. And then at the debate, right, I'm kind of jumping out, but one of the two main takeaways from the debate, the Tim Walz, J.D. Vance debate, was that J.D. Vance refused to say whether Trump won the election or not.
Right.
In a question about January 6th. So last question, he's asked about January 6th. He tries to dodge. Tim Walz says, would you care to answer the question? He dodges some more. And then Tim Walz says that's, you know, a really damning non-answer.
So that's right.
That's Tuesday night. Then Wednesday comes out.
Wednesday
comes out. 165 pages, and I'll get to that in a second. But then, and this had to have been already scheduled, but then last night, Kamala Harris and Liz Cheney do an event in, is it Ripon?
I think so. Ripon or Ripon, Wisconsin.
Wisconsin. So that one of the towns, in addition to Jackson, Michigan, that claims to be the birthplace of the Republican Party. And,
right.
And you know, as I was sitting there finishing my first read of the report, I'm like, Kamala Harris can't address this because there's a command influence problem. Like, she can't address it as the sitting vice president because Trump then will say, you've got a senior government official weighing in on this prosecution. You need to keep those separate. But instead, she goes and she does an event with one of the top experts in the country on January 6th. And so Liz Cheney made it a focus of what she said. So that's what the week looks like. Now, filing, there's not much new in the filing. It's sort of like a repackaging of what we already knew. A lot of it showed up in the January 6th report, although some didn't. I mean, one of the details, the most alarming detail, which Jack Smith kind of slipped in there, is that Nick Luna, who started as Trump's body man and had some other title in the White House, he rushes into Trump's dining room as shortly after Mike Pence has been whisked away to safety by the Secret Service. And this is minutes after Trump has sent, sitting alone in his dining room, that tweet saying Mike Pence didn't have the courage. So Nick Luna rushes into the dining room and says, oh, the Secret Service have rushed Mike Pence to safety. And Trump's response was,
so what?
So what? So what? Now that would not come in at trial, even if this does go to trial. Prosecutors aren't arguing for that. They really did slip it in because they're like, we, as further proof that the text, the tweet itself, Mike Pence didn't have the courage. Let me tell you what Trump said minutes after to Nick Luna. And so there's stuff like that in the briefing that they use to make the argument that stuff can come in, but that they're not proposing comes in. So that's one thing. Another thing, which was technically already public, but most people had missed it, was that Mike Roman, it's clear now that it's Mike Roman. It had probably, you know, I had thought it was Mike Roman when it was first released last December.
Uh-huh.
Mike Roman at the TCF Center in Michigan, which is where they counted all of Detroit's votes, right? And where that big violent rally was. Somebody said things are getting a little rabid here, kind of like the Brooks Brothers riot in 2000.
Right.
And Mike Roman said, let them riot.
Yes.
So those are the two pieces that were viewed as news. One is not news. There are a few more details. I'm going to write a post over the weekend about Steve Bannon. So it's always a good weekend when you're going to spend it with Steve Bannon.
Oh, yeah.
But, you know, one of the things that, The goal of this document is to convince the Supreme Court to let them take this case to trial, to convince the Supreme Court that you can have evidence from Mike Pence. I argued in a post today, there's also evidence from Eric Hirschman that I could see the Supreme Court throwing out. Dan Scavino is meant to testify about how Trump uses Twitter. There's a few more, like the Nick Luna one. There's another thing that Nick Luna witnessed Trump saying to Jared and Ivanka, oh yeah, we're just going to declare victory no matter what. So those are the things that are most at risk, I think, given the Supreme Court opinion. In addition, they go through 14 pages of the filing arguments for why they should be able to use Trump's tweets at trial.
Uh-huh.
And it's insane. I mean, like the notion that this is what we've come to in this country, because the tweets are lies about the election. The tweets are, and there's like 1,200 lies in the transition period, and by far the majority are lies about the election. There are, of course, the tweets to Mike Pence. There are tweets advertising the riot. But the key category is they list six people, actually eight people, that are Republicans that Donald Trump has threatened. Oh. That also happen to be involved with elections. One of them, by the way, is Brian Kemp. As we speak, Trump is headed to Georgia to make nice with Brian Kemp. God. But they describe that in from mid-November to January 3rd, so not even the entire transition, in that period, Trump tweeted about Brian Kemp 40 times.
Wow.
And they include these. And I'm like, OK, so you're John Roberts. And if you want to do what you're claiming you want to do, which is make Trump absolutely immune, you're effectively going to be arguing that writing mean tweets to other Republicans who've crossed you is the official duties of the president of the United States. I mean, that is the logic that they're going to ask you to embrace here. And they don't get into the threats against Kemp, but they do with Jeff Duncan. They do with some folks from Philadelphia separately. They don't even have to make this argument with Ruby Freeman and Shay Moss. Right. They're separate. That's not an official, like attacking them is not an official text at all. Rusty Bowers, right? So of course, Rusty Bowers, there were some, I think, Oath Keepers who came to his house and his daughter was quite ill. They go through, and Doug Ducey's in there.
Uh-huh.
So they go through all of these and say, can we please use these? Because we don't think that these count as official presidential. So that's the kind of thing that is in this filing. Oh, in the same time, Trump asked for an extension to mid-November for their response. And Tanya Chutkan gave them to November 7th. So we will not see Trump's response before the election.
Okay.
And then they're going to get a sir reply. So we're not going to be done with this until December, which is not that surprising. But, if Trump wins, it all goes away anyway.
Right.
If Trump wins, he's just going to blow off his deadlines because fuck it. He's, you know, what are they going to do? Arrest him?
Right.
But if he loses, then he's going to have to go fight this back to the Supreme Court. And if he loses, I think the Supreme Court will look at this and go, this is insane. Like, I don't think, when I heard the hearing for this, I was like, Sammy Alito literally believes the garbage that Donald Trump says.
Right.
And I think, I think Clarence Thomas, of course, has to. And I think that's one of the problems, which is that, Trump has led Republicans to believe a bunch of garbage. It's just not true. And so if they are forced to look at the truth, then maybe they're going to view things differently.
Right. But we also thought SCOTUS would rule. There is no such thing as absolute immunity. Of course, this is nonsense. And look what they did.
So, yeah. And I honestly, like, one of the things I pointed out in a post I did today is that they so Amy Coney Barrett is like, you have to be able to use official conduct in trial. Otherwise, the prohibition on bribery goes out the window, because how are you going to prove bribery if you can't use the official acts,
right,
that bribery paid off? And John Roberts wrote this ridiculous footnote three. Amy Anna Bowers at Lawfare wrote a really cool post on it. So I recommend, in my post, I have a link to hers.
Right.
John Roberts is like, they can get it from the public records. They just can't talk about the official. It's insane. I mean, that footnote is insane, but Roberts is trying to make a ridiculous argument. Amy Coney Barrett, I think, was like, in general, I'm willing to sign on to this aggressive opinion, but here's a problem with it. And she just sort of sticks this lever in the opinion that I think when it goes back to the Supreme Court, which it's guaranteed to do, it'll work the same way that Braun has, right? That's the gun that's where they said, because there's no record of gun, of any prohibitions on gun ownership in the 1770s, you know, we can't have any prohibitions on gun ownership. Mm-hmm. And then things keep showing up at Supreme Court. They will continue to show up. You know, Hunter Biden will show up at the Supreme Court. And the arguments that now the Supreme Court is dealing with, that are kind of insane. Like, Peter Sagal, the wait guy, did the best encapsulation of what happened when these Braun opinions went back to the Supreme Court, where, you know, everyone's like, come on, we didn't really mean it seriously. And then Clarence Thomas is like, yes, I did. You know, it's just this one tweet of how when faced with the logical outcomes of their own opinion, Supreme Court was like, whoa, hold on a second. I didn't mean that. And I think that some of that's going to happen if this gets back to them. If Trump wins, it's going to be gone. They're not going to have to deal with it. If Trump loses, it's going to come back to them and they'll have less of incentive. I mean, they don't want to make Kamala Harris the, you know, absolutely immune.
Right. Because it works, you know, you can't give it to Trump and not give it to Harris. So there is that. But, you know, you mentioned the bribery. The Supreme Court basically said, well, bribery is okay as long as we call it a tip.
Bribery is okay as long as we call it a gratuity. We should expect Eric Adams's indictment to go up there. You know, people are already warning. Let's see where this actually goes. They did in a hearing the other day say that it's probable that it'll be superseded with other people added with some obstruction charges. I don't know if they're going to go to foreign agent charges with him, but, you know, it'd be logical. They did announce yesterday that they are going to use what's called SEPA, which is they're going to have there's classified intelligence that they will need to deal with one way or another.
So you mentioned also that Vance in the debate, which was just Tuesday night, the vice presidential debate, which we can talk about. But he refused. That was like the moment of the debate because, you know, some people were saying, well, Vance won. He showed what a smooth liar he is. I mean, I could go off on that. But last night, somebody, there's a couple of guys called the Good Liars, who are, you know, they're sort of the yes men of this election cycle. For old people who remember the yes men, they would show up and do poses, people they weren't. Well, the Good Liars have taken over that mantle. Anyway, one of them chased down J.D. Vance yesterday. And, oh, do I have... Well, here, I'll just play the audio if this works.
Who won the 2020 election?
We're going to go to town hall.
Could you just answer, did Donald Trump win, yes or no?
Yes.
He did win.
Yep.
So will you concede? Will you concede?
This is being really difficult.
If your opponent gets more votes, will you concede?
I really feel bad for you, man.
I just want to know, if your opponent gets more votes, will you concede?
And then he left. But he said, did Trump win? And he said, yes. Now, he wouldn't say that a couple of days ago in the debate. Now he tells this guy on camera, yeah, Trump won. So these people are just, they're beyond, they know no shame. We'll get to the debate in a bit. But stuff like that, I guess it doesn't matter. Lying is okay in their world. And in fact, I guess this does go to the debate. The one thing that Vance got all pissed off about was they fact-checked him on a very simple matter. I can't even remember which one it was. It was, I don't even know. But the you know, there's supposed to be no fact-checking here. And his complaint, his response to, you know, the concern that democracy is at risk, that they fomented this insurrection is, well, Kamala Harris wants to censor people and keep us from stating mistruths. I mean, to censor people to stop them from lying. And they have a problem with that. Are they trying to say lying should be, you know, that this is part of their rights as Americans?
Speaking of which, if you didn't read, there was an article by Wall Street Journal yesterday or the day before that described that Elon Musk was funding one of Stephen Miller's groups. This was tied to his support of DeSantis, but it suggests that he has financial ties to Stephen Miller because Stephen Miller doesn't have to announce who funds his right-wing law firm.
Right.
And so it's, you know, that they got to it. And this is Wall Street Journal. This is good reporting in Wall Street Journal, important reporting. But the import of this cannot be overstated because it is true that there has been an effort by white nationalists effectively since Elon bought Twitter to undermine moderation.
Right.
But, you know, this is why they're still so interested in what they call the Hunter Biden laptop. Now, as this is happening, right, this week, Ken Klippenstein, who used to work at The Intercept, posted the J.D. Vance dossier that Iran stole from the campaign. And Elon immediately did exactly what Twitter did with the quote unquote Hunter Biden laptop, the New York Post story, except he kicked Klippenstein off forever.
Twitter, right. Yeah.
Like there was like Klippenstein is not back. He's never going to be back. That cuts his income because he's a Substacker now. And it's the same. It's this, you know, yes, we have good reason to believe that that dossier was stolen by Iran, but nevertheless, And Elon said, well, it's for privacy reasons. And the privacy reasons were like the last four digits of your SOCH and address, which is public. It's the same kind of thing, by the way, that Donald Trump posted of Barack Obama.
Right.
Which led to an armed Jan Sixer stalking the Calorama neighborhood of Washington Post. That prosecution is still going forward. It's the same thing that shows up over and over again in the tweets that Jack Smith wants to rely on because he's posting the phone numbers of people like Mike Shirky, the then Michigan Senate Majority Leader, that, you know, he just got slammed with people criticizing him because he wouldn't throw the election for Donald Trump. So Elon Musk censors Klippenstein for something that Trump does all the time. That, I mean, obviously the privacy disclosures in the Hunter Biden laptop, which are still out there. I mean, like even the Garrett Ziegler copy, there are some redactions in there, but the stuff that it's the same level of redaction that showed up in this dossier, you know, total double standard.
Yes.
It is being censored. The Klippenstein story is being censored in other outlets, but they're doing it under the name of foreign malign influence. And I'm, you know, if you're going to say we're not going to let Iran fiddle in our elections, then I'm happy to have it. But it was reasonable when the Hunter Biden laptop was posted to at least suspect that it was foreign malign influence. We still can't rule it out because Rudy Giuliani was sidling up to a known Russian spy, Andrei Derkach. And it, like, the effort was the same. Rudy literally said, I consider it the same effort.
Right.
This, me having this laptop. So so obviously Elon Musk is an utter hypocrite about all of this. But they, you know, I've written this about this a lot. Like in 2016, white nationalists succeeded in helping Trump win. In fact, the webmaster of Daily Stormer, a guy named Weave, was involved in this. So like a literal Nazi. They carried out this quasi-professional effort to hijack Hillary's hashtags, to hijack the narrative of the news. And they were really successful. This is also, by the way, Don Jr. probably used this group to support the John Podesta emails. Mm-hmm. And then in 2020, you saw that effort wildly expand. Like the Stanford Election Integrity Project did a study of which false narratives were tremendously successful, not who told the most lies, but who told lies that were most successful at being disseminated. And the answer was, not surprisingly, Donald Trump, his two sons, right, his intelligence director of national intelligence, his cat turd, Jack Posobiec, and Mike Roman, who is the guy that we talked about earlier, who said, let them riot at the TCF Center.
Wow.
So 2020, hugely successful. But nevertheless, their disinformation got labeled. It didn't get taken down. It got labeled or throttled. And then after the election, the social media companies turned off that throttling. They're like, election's over. We can turn off the throttling. Well, what happened? Where did Stop the Steal organize? It actually organized not on Twitter, but especially on Facebook. Uh-huh. It goes wild on Facebook, leads to an insurrection. And I say this a lot. People, I think, don't appreciate this. It's not clear we would have gotten to the inauguration if Twitter hadn't shut down Donald Trump, because there was all this ongoing planning. I mean, people were stockpiling weapons after January 6th didn't work. They're like, we've got to come back for the inauguration.
Right.
The threat of massive political, I mean, because they all said, too, like, next time we come back with guns.
Right.
We didn't bring guns. Next time we come back with guns. And so I think were it not for shutting down Twitter, you would have had this successful insurrection. Now we see I've talked about political violence here in Ireland focused on migrants organized on Twitter. In fact, there was one event where Alex Jones retweet of Tommy Robinson, who's a white nationalist in the UK, was really instrumental in publicizing that thing. And then the UK riots, where Elon Musk said civil war is inevitable. Now you've got Elon Musk, who is, you know, an old apartheid guy, running this thing that he dumped. Now it's only worth his $44 billion investment is only worth 30. He's lost $35 billion on it. It's worth $9 billion at this point.
That's frightening. And
he routinely supports right wing racist violence.
Right.
And so knowing that, that Stephen Miller and him have ties, there were texts released back in 2021 or 2022 when Musk was buying Twitter. And there was one where somebody described how you bring Donald Trump back to Twitter. And he referred to Donald Trump as the boss or something. And everyone, for a variety of reasons, people are like, that looks like it's Stephen Miller.
Uh-huh.
And, you know, if it was Miller, then it suggests Miller is in on the front end of Elon Musk buying Twitter. And a lot of, I mean, it makes sense, but now you've got not just coordination, but huge amounts of money being spent to popularize these just disgusting racist lines. Because they also found that's what the story mainly focuses on, is he's funding these racist lies about immigration. And that's a really toxic situation. It's a really I've written two posts where I say Twitter is a machine for fascism. Mm-hmm. You've got a white nationalist involved who has coordination with Donald Trump's discount Goebbels. We discovered this week that Jack Posobiec is behind an account. He runs two on Twitter, one of which is the End Wokeness. People thought it was him anyway, but there's increasing confirmation that it's him.
Right.
And that he's End Wokeness was critically important for pushing the cats and dogs in Springfield,
right,
for example.
Yep.
And so that, you know, you've got this happening in real time. And so Stephen Miller's at the center of it. And Elon Musk is at the center of it. And so it really raises questions about how we get through, you know, even if Kamala wins.
Yes.
How we get through to inauguration without a lot of political violence.
Oh, yeah. Well, now that brings me to the next question, because in the post you wrote this morning at emptywheel.net that's headlined "How Jack Smith Wants to Prove Trump's Crimes," you wrote, "There's no telling how SCOTUS will respond to this. I'm particularly interested in the tactical decision to call the Brooks Brothers riot, quote, a violent effort to stop the vote count in Florida after the 2000 presidential election, in a filing that aims to persuade John Roberts, Brett Kavanaugh, and Amy Coney Barrett." That is interesting. I mean, it was a violent effort to stop that. But are you saying that Jack Smith should have toned it down because of the audience, who this.
I have no idea. I'm trying to get people like George Conway I'm trying to get people who can get their minds around this about how they will respond. I mean, it's not that these justices were part of the mob itself, although Kavanaugh was pretty close to it. It's that they were part of a larger effort. I mean, they were in that moment the equivalent of the John Eastman,
right,
who had ties to the Mike Roman saying, let them riot.
Right.
You know, Mike Roman is literally on. I think this is true. Mike Roman is either on texts with John Eastman or one degree removed. Oh, right. So and so they are quite close. Those efforts are quite close. And here we are 24 years later. And these three justices who were involved in George Bush's legal efforts in 2000 are weighing in on the same toxic combination of lawfare and political violence.
And what's really frightening is we know what happened in 2000. Just think how the course of history would have been different had Sandra Day O'Connor done the right thing there. Had they not totally ruled, and it was only good for that one case, Bush v. Gore. So allegedly not setting any precedent, but of course they set a precedent. Right.
There's already, if you follow Mark Elias, he still does a lot of his shitting on Shitter.
Yes, he does.
He says there's already more lawsuits than there was in 2020. So same effort. Right. And he has expanded his own effort. But, that they're doing it again. Like, there are these efforts all over Georgia where they're like, oh, yeah, known counties. They're like, well, we don't have to certify if Trump loses this county. And so, as I said, Donald Trump is there this week with Brian Kemp. Last time Brian Kemp made a difference. But you've got more nutballs in different places than you did then. By the way, one of the things that I should have mentioned in that post this morning, which I forgot to, is that one of the arguments they make about the calls that Trump was making to people like Doug Ducey is that it's not Doug Ducey who's in charge of elections in Arizona.
No,
it's not Rusty Bowers who's in charge of elections in Arizona.
Right.
So, the argument that Trump has been making, which is that he just made these calls because he was concerned about the conduct of the election, doesn't make sense because, one, he wasn't calling the people, with the exception of Georgia, I think, he wasn't calling the people who actually are in charge of counting the votes. But in addition, he wasn't calling the people in state, like he wasn't calling in Michigan because Democrats were running that in Michigan.
Right.
It's a point that a lot of people have made. Or when he was saying we need to challenge the election, he wasn't calling on any of these members of Congress to challenge their own elections, right?
Right.
He had no problem with their elections.
Every other election was valid.
People have made over and over and over again about Trump's claims, but they do make that in the filing, which I think is an important point.
Good. I'm glad they bring that up. Just what you just said. Every other election, every down ballot race in wherever it is, those were perfectly fine. The only one that was stolen was the presidential. There's so many holes in this. It's just absurd. But so then there's this thing going on, and it's happening around the country where the balls they set in motion 4 years ago are coming back. But there is some pushback in Colorado just yesterday. A county clerk was the judge gave this clerk 9 years in prison. The judge called her a charlatan.
Tina Peters. Yep.
Yeah, Tina Peters. So 9 years in prison, that's not nothing.
No, and you can go on Twitter and listen to the judge's statements about sentencing her because he brought up the fact that she was she had no remorse. She kept trying to be the center of attention. In her sentence, she was like, oh, I didn't do this. I didn't ask for the attention. He's like, of course you did. Yes, you did. And so that's a really important, like, this is tied to the aftermath of Trump. What she did was she let somebody in and actually access the county machines. By the way, one of the claims in Georgia is an old Dominion claim. And one of the, they're still making the Dominion argument after Dominion won that. Like, you would think that they know, they of course don't know about the Fox settlement, but right. Fox settled $750 million. By the way, Smartmatic and Newsmax settled yes. this week
right.
or last week.
We as talked
well.
About that last week, and we don't know any of the details because they settled and we're not privy to the settlement.
Yeah. But the other thing that Jack Smith's filing does is he expands on, in the indictment itself, he's like, oh, you know, Donald Trump was laughing at Sidney Powell, but then he went and used her claims publicly, including on the January 6th speech. He provides a lot more details. Like, he literally had Eric Hirschman and somebody else on speakerphone. He like called up Sidney Powell, put her on speakerphone and muted her, and they were all laughing at her at how stupid she was about Dominion. Oh, and then and they also include, speaking of the Dominion lawsuit against Fox, they include Tucker Carlson's pushback against Sidney Powell. And that's sort of what snowballs this, is Tucker Carlson attacks them. They're like, this is garbage. But of course, the point is that we're having this legal argument. Can that information come in? The fact that Eric Hirschman was witness to Donald Trump making fun of Sidney Powell before he repeatedly used Sidney Powell's claims about Dominion, or is Trump immune somehow because, you know, his relationship with Eric Hirschman, who, by the way, you know, they make this point. They're like, Eric Hirschman got hooked up with Donald Trump because he was childhood friends with Jared.
Oh, God. Eric Hirschman's the guy who people might recall. I'm obsessed with the room that he gave his testimony in during the January 6th commission hearings, because it looked to me like he was in the bathroom and he had some kind of panda on the shower. I know it wasn't. It's just weird artwork, I guess. But that's how I remember Eric Hirschman. And apparently, you know, he talks like us. He likes the F word a lot. So.
Oh, yeah. He's like, he puts my potty mouth to shame.
Mine, too. I know.
And that makes it into the filing, by the way. You know, oh, your claims are bullshit. And so at least we have that to look forward to.
Of course.
Eric Hirschman.
So there was, Trump bitched about the length of Jack Smith's filing, which was 165 pages. And now we know that you said the response, the deadline now is November 7th for Trump's response. Did I read that it's going to be 180 pages?
Well, that's the limit that Jack Smith asked for. So he's asking for the same limit. And what they're going to file, it sounds like, is their own first brief. They're going to say, and they're going to focus much more on the legal issues. They don't want to deal with the details. So you're going to have two parallel. That's what's going to happen.
Gotcha. So, but again, we won't have. So this is the last word. We had hoped. If we look back on the last 4-8 years, and we had hoped that some of these cases, the 4 indictments against the former guy, we have some trials before the election. Turns out we had the one, and the others, no. This is it. This filing from Jack Smith is going to be the last official court proceeding before the election, or is there other stuff going on in Trump trial land, like with Eileen Cannon or... the other case that's brewing that, of course, is slipping my mind at the moment. Do we expect anything else between now and November 5th?
I doubt it. Like the Eileen Cannon case is before the 11th Circuit right now, but I just don't think that they're going to schedule a hearing until after the election. Right. There's some various appeals in New York. It is what it is. I think this filing... Of course, you know, it's hard. Like, even I'm telling you, there's very little that's new in here. Uh-huh. So it's hard. Like, people were criticizing the New York Times saying, well, you know, they're not treating this like Hillary's emails. That's true. For the two reporters who covered it, Charlie Savage and Alan Foyer, who are both very good reporters, they're honestly saying there's not much new here. Whatever.
Right. By the way, and we heard the news. So what? Right. And the other thing about the that you mentioned about the violent, the Brooks Brothers riot. Right.
Well, I mean, there's a few other details. There are two things that I came away. This is my freebie for your listeners, because okay. I kind of nodded to this in a post. I said in a post that given what we saw in this filing, I would be unsurprised to see other charges after the election, not just other people, particularly if Trump loses, then you can charge all the co-conspirators. But just as one example, and this isn't the only thing that should be in this filing that is not. Jack Smith makes an argument that a speech Trump gave on January 4th, 2021 in Atlanta is a campaign speech. And he makes that argument. And so that's part of how he argues that the January 6th speech is a campaign speech. He says this is a campaign speech because he talks about victory. This is before, of course, the primary in Georgia. And then he says, and these are basically the same speech. They're very similar. By the way, part of the speech says, oh, Supreme Court rules against me. Those jerks won't help me out. So he actually includes in the brief how Trump attacked the Supreme Court in 2021 for not ruling their way, which, again, is this other interesting tactical move along with the Brooks Brothers thing. But and then he says, you know, there are other reasons. There are other ways he argues that the Georgia speech is a campaign speech. Like he says, the people who were with Trump were given a Hatch Act warning, meaning you can't do anything in your official presence for this campaign. But interestingly, he said they sent out fundraising emails for that rally.
Right.
Which is true. Like they're saying, hey, we're help us move to victory now.
But then, wait a minute, this was 2021. So after the election, 2 days before the January 6th uprising or before the election, 2020?
2021. This is like after the Georgia. Yeah.
The Senate race. Is that
the Senate race? This is
I got it. Okay. Yep. The Senate race in Georgia, which was a special election. Okay.
Yep. So like Loeffler and Perdue are both some of the masked identities in the filing.
Yes. But
Smith doesn't talk about the fundraising tied to January 6th.
Okay.
And when I predicted back in August that he was going to supersede the indictment, I'm like, one of the ways you can respond to this immunity ruling is to say, well, we'll just charge Donald Trump for all the things that he did after he was no longer president, such as using money raised on a promise of election integrity that you then use to pay all your lawyers. And it's something that he did a lot of work on and ultimately didn't charge, but it's out there, right? Like, right. So I found that that is one of two things I found in the filing that should be there and is not. Like, if you're going to talk about the parallel between the January 4th speech and the January 6th speech, and you're going to say that the January 4th speech is a campaign speech because of the fundraising attached, well, hell, he was fundraising right up until the moment people attacked the Capitol, right? We know that from the January 6th committee, but it doesn't show up in the filing. And I'm like, that's interesting. So that's one thing about it. The other thing is I said, well, okay, maybe he'll charge all of the co-conspirators, right? So there were originally six. We've taken out Jeffrey Clark because John Roberts said we had to. And so there remain the same five co-conspirators. And they still have their same names. So like Rudy Giuliani is co-conspirator one.
Right.
Well, what's interesting, well, first of all, like they make it much more clear. And they did this in the filing where they first revealed this back in December. But they make it much more clear that they're treating Mike Roman as a co-conspirator. And partly they're doing that just for legal reasons. Like by arguing they're a co-conspirator, you can get their words in against Donald Trump without having to call them to testify. But what's interesting about the filing is person one. So the first person described outside of the co-conspirators is Steve Bannon. And it takes a very different take on Steve Bannon than you saw in the indictment. So Steve Bannon describes that before the election, Donald Trump said he was going to declare victory. Steve Bannon, many of the references in the brief are the same ones that show up in the January 6th committee report, meaning that you would see Bannon make claims on his podcast. The word Willard actually shows up in the filing, which I'm surprised more people didn't make a big stink out of. And while most of the references to Bannon, like one of the references to Bannon technically is also in the January 6th report, although it's not as obvious, the way they deal with it is not as obvious, which is that Donald Trump speaks to Bannon for an extended period on January 5th. And this is in the period where he's trying to pressure Pence. Mm-hmm. And then Bannon goes on the air and makes his famous comment that all hell's going to break loose on January 6th.
Right.
So Jack Smith leaves the impression that something Trump told Bannon led Bannon to know in advance that all hell was going to break loose, that they were intentionally going to create all hell breaking loose, and that that was tied to Mike Pence. Now, what's interesting about it is Bannon, in the few areas where this Jack Smith filing goes further than the January 6th reports, it's about meetings at the Willard.
Okay.
So in other words, and remember that Jack Smith got Boris Epstein's phone. He got Mike Roman's phone. He, by the way, DOJ is still working on getting Proton mail from Peter Navarro.
Okay.
But whatever, Navarro, whatever. Navarro, there's a point in the filing where they're like, oh, Peter Navarro's tweet comes in because he was a Hatch Act recidivist. He always was in violation of laws prohibiting the use of White House property to engage in politicking. But there's, for example, I think this comes from Boris Epstein's calendar.
Okay.
I'm going to write it up over the weekend, right? But there are a few things where it talks about what John Eastman, Rudy Giuliani, Boris Epstein, and Steve Bannon did at the Willard in the days leading up to January 6th. So we finally have the Willard Hotel in the stink of things. And Steve Bannon is in it, right?
Uh-huh.
Now, why wasn't that in the original indictment? You know, it may be that it took a while to crack these communications. It may be that, I mean, I'll write it up over the weekend and maybe I'll come to some hypotheses about why Steve Bannon is in there. By the way, the New York Times, the same reporters who people are complaining aren't talking enough, they note that Steve Bannon's all over this thing as well, like in a way that he isn't elsewhere.
Right.
What's interesting, it just puts Bannon... It puts Bannon in the indictment in a way he wasn't before. So, for example, there's a statement again that's in the January 6th report where he's talking to his Chinese colleagues, who I believe is Guo Wenwei, who meanwhile is disseminating doctored pictures of Hunter Biden on Twitter. These are the ones that got taken down. It's like the net here is so like they're all the same people.
Right.
That's who Bannon told Trump was going to declare victory. Now, Guo has since been convicted of all sorts of fraud. And there was a piece yesterday in Mother Jones about Bannon and Guo.
Okay.
I'm forgetting the details, but go look. Daniel Friedman, and he's like the Guo expert.
Wow.
And here's what it is Bannon was threatening... Roger Stone's associate, extorting him basically. And then there are these. So this is what Bannon is doing in October. And then there's this interesting reference where the filing is like, oh, Bannon was back super involved in Trump's efforts starting on December 13th or 14th. And that's really telling. So there's going to be, like, I would, you know, again, you got to go vote. You got to make sure that Kamala Harris wins, because otherwise this stuff comes out in a report. We don't get the actual. But I would be unsurprised. I'll put it that way. I would be unsurprised to see additional charges. Because the other thing that happened, right, when I predicted correctly that Jack Smith was going to supersede, mm-hmm. They didn't say we need time to supersede, which is how they on paper use the time. They said, we need time to discuss with others in DOJ the timing of how we're going to do this.
Okay.
So maybe they were just talking about whether they should wait to supersede until after the election, or maybe there was a discussion about whether they should add charges in. It was August 27th that they superseded. Or whether that was too close to the election involving Donald Trump. And, you know, like I said, given what the Supreme Court told Jack Smith, which is that you can't prosecute Donald Trump for anything that he did as president. Right. One option is you go prosecute him for fraud, the same kind of fraud. By the way, Michelle Fiore, who kind of this is the same kind of level of person as Tina Peters, the woman who was sentenced for nine years. Yeah. Michelle Fiore is a Las Vegas right wing politician. And she was famous for taking pictures of herself with like guns in her underwear, I think. She was convicted yesterday of the same kind of charity fraud that Donald Trump and Steve Bannon both have. I mean, Donald Trump was entered into that settlement. Steve Bannon's co-conspirators all are in jail. Steve Bannon faces trial for that.
Oh,
days
not for
after
that.
The election.
Right. Okay. Well, Steve Bannon is in jail as we speak, and he's going to be out just a few days before the election, right?
Correct. Yeah.
And now and then he's facing trial on another charge, and that doesn't even include the stuff that's named in this filing.
Correct. And I'll also say that then we can drop my Steve Bannon. Now everyone doesn't have to read my post that I'm writing this weekend because I just explained where it's going. But Steve Bannon, what's interesting is Steve Bannon shows up in more substantive way in conjunction with Boris Epstein. And that's unsurprising.
Uh-huh.
They're known associates, but there was also an investigation of the two of them for the same kind of cryptocurrency scam that Trump just rolled out a couple of weeks ago. So they're under investigation for like bilking a bunch of Trump dupes into buying their cryptocurrency and then cashing out and running away with money. Oh, by the way, speaking of in addition to Trump's watch that he rolled out over the week,
the $100,000
watch, you know, sell 50 of them to Saudi Arabia and all of a sudden you've got campaign donations.
Yeah.
There's a report out from ProPublica today describing how four people were ousted from Truth Social for whistleblowing against Devin Nunes. Right.
Ooh.
And maybe this is the story to ProPublica about him going to Macedonia, or he's got like this is where Rumble is hosted.
Uh-huh.
Rumble, right? There's all this network. I'm sorry, I sound like a crazy person when I describe it, but it's all real,
right? No, this, if somebody, you know, put aside reality for a moment, if somebody say 10 years ago came up with a script about the last 8 years and brought it to a studio to get a movie produced, they'd laugh him out of the room. Like, are you crazy? This is so implausible. Yet this is what we've been living for the last 8 years, 10 years.
Oh, and this was maybe a new detail, maybe not a new detail, but something else about the Jack Smith filing that people loved is Rudy tried to issue threats against, I think, Mike Chatfield, another one of the Michigan legislators, mm-hmm. the Speaker of the House. And got the number wrong. So he failed in his effort to. He did manage to oust the RNC, council. And that may be partly new. That's not actually in the January 6th committee. He basically said, you know, you're not being very loyal. I'm going to get you fired. And then, you know, eventually he was fired. So.
Oh, God. Yeah, but the revelation that he texted the stuff to the wrong number is it's perfect. It's just perfect. It's so, you know, what else? What else can you say about Rudy? His daughter, I guess, has a thing going around social media where she said, Donald Trump, you know, stole my father. Don't let him steal the country or something like that. Like she was brutal. Like her father has been brainwashed.
Yeah, she endorsed Harris for just that reason.
Yeah.
And, yeah. And, you know, Rudy's trying to sell his house out before Ruby Freeman gets it. And RFK Jr., there's new, like, first of all, there's other women coming out with saying that they had a relationship with him. He's now going to be divorced. There's now rumors that his law firm got paid $100,000 before he endorsed. Like, it's just so much grift. you know, like, really, you just need to go back to the golden watches. It's like that all the way. Trump is like, it's not clear whether he needs this money to run on, whether he is trying to get as much out of the grift as he can before he faces the possibility of being beaten by a black woman, which is going to ruin his brand. It's just... it's like, I sound like a crazy person, Nicole.
Yeah, but it is insane. And with that, I should play this.
Hello, this is Attorney Roy Cohn. When I'm not creating controversy, I like to listen to WMCA New York. Top of the hour to you.
It's muffled because that's, about 50 years old. But Roy, this is Attorney Roy Cohn. When I'm not creating controversy, I'm listening to WMCA. Good guy radio. Yeah.
I know, we should play that every time I'm on because I'm so chuffed that you have that.
I should add it into the intro. I'll revamp the intro and put him in there. Try to unmuffle the audience.
Because we might as well have Roy Cohn. Did we forget anything? We're like...
The debate. The vice presidential debate where, J.D. Vance. And by the way, you've seen the pictures, the photoshopped photos of J.D. Vance. So some congressman took J.D. Vance's official, portrait, Senate photograph, and photoshopped it. I used a number of the then subsequent photoshops of this portrait on my show card. You know, Howie Klein is on with me on Thursday, so I'll put up what I used yesterday. Hold on. We have no audio here. Let me add the audio to it. 1 second. Audio went away. Here we go. Okay. No, audio still doesn't work. Want to work. I'll try it this way. Okay. There. All right. Now we have audio. All right. So... none of these are his official Senate portrait. The one on the left with the balls hanging from his chin was the first one that some congressman shitted out. And I'm going to see, I do have somewhere the side by side. Let me see if I can find the actual original. I wasn't planning on doing this, but this is a graphic depiction of how he lies, here's the side by side. All right. This is just too precious. The picture on the left is this, chubby J.D. Vance or whatever he's calling himself today. That's his official picture. Somebody took that and chiseled his features, made his eyes bluer, turned him up just slightly, made him into like this good looking guy. And he's not. And then other people took that and then played with it a little bit more. I think this is a graphic depiction of how J.D. Vance lies. A little smoother than Donald Trump, but just as blatant a lie as anything. The guy is just, he's smarmy. He's a Yale-educated lawyer. He's good at debating. But my God, he lied about everything just with a little more... with a smile instead of this.
Yeah, as I described, he's like Donald Trump, he's a sociopath. Unlike Donald Trump, he's not a narcissist. Right. So Kamala Harris succeeded by getting inside his skin. You can't do that with him because he is a vehicle for people like Peter Thiel rather than, for himself. And that's why the Peter Thiels of the world really love him.
But Peter Thiel never came up in the debate. A lot of things didn't come up in the debate that could have. That said, I think Tim Walz did a decent job. Could have been better.
VP debates never make a difference.
No,
never.
They don't.
So if that clip of JD refusing to say whether Trump won or lost goes anywhere, then you're ahead of the game with the debate. If that clip of JD saying the rules were no fact checking, if that goes anywhere, we're ahead with the debate. Otherwise, neither of them damaged their candidate. We move on. We didn't talk about war breaking out in the Middle East.
No, that, like, we did not.
We avoided a longshoreman strike. It lasted a day. And that's great. So that's one. I mean, I wrote this post in August and said, here are the things that could happen. And I did a post last week and I was like, or this week, I don't remember. Oh, I did it Monday, I think, because that was the one third left mark for Kamala Harris. Yep. And I was like, pretty much four of the things that I said could happen are happening. We've got war breaking out. We've got something major happening. The Jack Smith brief. We've got, so it's still not affecting the polling, but the war breaking out could. I very much worry. We didn't talk about the actual substance of the Liz Cheney event yesterday, which was just as a Gen Xer, it was a weird moment for me. And as somebody who's written a shit ton about Liz Cheney's father,
yes,
trying to say all the words that right. I won't let myself use anymore now that they've endorsed. But it was, you know, it was like this very Reagan-esque thing. I do get a kick out of them going to Ripon. I, in 2008, made a point of going and canvassing in Jackson, Michigan, which is where the other, you know, the other home of the Republican Party was, because I thought it really, you know, important that the Republican Party used to do something about African-Americans, about slaves, right? And so it was sort of the symbolism of Liz Cheney and Kamala Harris, and both of them, by the way, lived in Wisconsin when their parents were at UW, at University of Wisconsin. So they're like, we don't have anything in common except that we were here as kids. Liz Cheney was born in Wisconsin because her parents were at UW. So they both went through UW. But it's weird because it's just like, what, you know, I came of age under Reagan, mm-hmm. as did Liz Cheney. That's what she said.
Right.
As did Ted Cruz, as did Marco Rubio, as did, you know, all of these Republicans. You know, when I made this point, people were like, well, yeah, they tried to beat Donald Trump in 2016 and all lost spectacularly. And, you know, you had all of these men who might be the second incarnation of Ronald Reagan. That's what they believed when they entered into politics. Uh-huh. And then all that's left is Liz Cheney standing on a stage with Kamala Harris endorsing a Democrat.
Right.
And it was genuinely hard to get my brain around.
Yeah, it was surreal seeing them together and listening to Liz Cheney's words, and the fact that I'm respecting and agreeing with her, because I never thought that would ever happen in my lifetime. But I give her a lot of credit for standing up, because it's like the emperor's new clothes. She's the only one, or the first one, to come out and say, look at him. He's naked. You don't want to look at him because he's naked. I do have respect for her. Still don't like her, but I really appreciate her doing this. And so should the country.
You know, and I, like, there was a picture of Jeff Duncan, who, going back to the people in Georgia that Trump has threatened, I mean, his life was thrown upside down. He did a post from, I think it was Georgia, maybe, you know, he did a tweet from an event he's doing with Republicans for Harris. And there were maybe 70 people there, 50 people there. It was a small turnout event for somebody who used to be a senior official in Georgia. But these Republicans who have endorsed Kamala Harris are putting in a lot of work at low turnout events. I mean, the event in Wisconsin wasn't a huge event at all. It was at a university. But they're putting in time at these low turnout events. And the idea is, if you can squeeze 10,000 votes from Republicans of the Nikki Haley supporters in North Carolina, that's how you win the state. That's how you win in Georgia again. That's how you make a difference in Michigan and so that's the logic behind it. I don't know if it'll work. I don't know whether Kamala Harris should have instead been trying to make things right with the Arab and Muslim community in Michigan. I don't know whether that's going to lose her the state. I guess we'll find out in a month.
Yes.
But we keep plodding through.
Right. The Republicans for Harris thing, though, I'll tell you, here in Arizona, I see billboards, a lot of them, billboards and signs that people are putting out. Republicans for Harris, independents for Harris. The other day, I saw one that said moderates for Harris.
And Jeff Flake endorsed this week.
And like, Jeff Flake
endorsed. One of the other things they're doing, and they've done this in the past, but they're doing, is they're trying to reach out to the Mormon vote, which in Arizona is a very important constituency, same in Nevada. And, you know, again, you don't need to turn that many Mormon voters to vote for Kamala Harris, Jeff Flake Mormon, right? So is the mayor from... where is the
Mesa? There's a Mesa, and he's the co-chair of Republicans for Harris nationally.
Yep.
Jeff Giles, John Giles.
In the last week or so, one of Nikki Haley's co-chairs in Michigan endorsed, and again, that comes with a network, and so we'll see whether it works. I mean, maybe it's a bad decision, but Kamala Harris. I mean, one thing is she's not leaving anything. She's trying not to leave anything to chance. She's going to have Barack out starting over the weekend. Yes. Biden is going to start doing some. So, you know, they're whatever.
They're going all in because, look, it's now or never. I mean, this is it. And we say this every 4 years. I know. And each time we say it, it's legitimate, but it's never been this crucial before.
Well,
I think.
I mean, 2020 but was. As
I know.
Well.
I know.
Just like. And I think people were naive about the risk that Donald Trump poses. I think people now are more, I mean, let's,
we'll see. I'll tell you, my new neighborhood, we were very heartened to see a house three doors down has a Harris sign. When we showed up last night or yesterday afternoon to bring another load over, because we're bringing over a carload at a time, the house across the street had a Harris sign on. And David said to me, we should bring one of the, we've got a few of them. We should bring the Harris sign to it. So we did last night. We put the Harris sign in front of our new house. But our new neighborhood in Andy Biggs congressional district. My street alone has three Harris signs so far. So I'm feeling good about that. More power to us. Marcy Wheeler, find her at emptywheel.net. It's necessary reading every day. And I thank you so much for being here. Just a footnote is we talked about it last week. On Wednesday, I'll be in the new studio, but I will have a live interview with Christopher Steele of the infamous dossier. I have the book now. I just got it yesterday, unredacted. And I had a long talk with Jason Leopold this morning about this, because remember, Jason was at BuzzFeed and they're the ones who published that dossier. So we'll see how it goes. I'm not looking to eviscerate the guy, but I want to get some answers from him, especially want to find out about the P tape. So we'll get that. You never know where we go. We'll see. Marcy Wheeler, as always, thank you so much. And we'll talk next week.
All right. Take care. Have
Thank
a good
you.
Week. Good luck
you
with too. The move.
Thank you. This is, I can't wait till it's over. Then we'll have a party. And by the way, the new house has a full guest room. So you have an open invitation anytime. You want to come out and cover another trial? In Los Angeles, you come stay here in Phoenix. Right. Or just come on vacation. Thanks, Marcy. We'll talk next week. Thanks, everybody. Have a wonderful weekend. Peace out.